Just a few things before I introduced Jim Melchert. All of you people of the mud, just really want to thank you for being here the last few days and being part of what we've experienced. So just as a representative from NCECA, thank you. So. Just two very quick points that I think are really important to make is the programming comes from you. You create the programming. It's the people that submit. So please, if you have an idea of creating a panel or you have a thought that needs to be heard, please submit it because you create the programming. And talking with all of you, you have amazing ideas, so just bring them forward. And the second point I want to make is probably the most important decisions that the board makes is deciding the programming. And I want to just have to say this, that the executive director, Josh Green, is one of the most ethical and honorable people I have ever worked with. And whenever there's a conflict of interest, NCECA tries to be aware of this, and I just have to tell you, with the emerging talent that we just saw, I was absolutely blown away by that talent. Yeah. And I have to say, I was, in full disclosure, is surprised and frankly proud to see that there were three former Penn State students in that, but I had nothing to do with that. So. And just maybe a repeat that it was NCECA and their discussions are constantly aware of fairness and honesty and representation, and we agonize over the decisions of not being biased or just that conflict of interest. Okay. I'd like to introduce Jim Melchert. Jim has been an integral part of the Bay Area's artistic evolution over the last five decades. From 1965 to 1992, he taught at UC Berkeley. He also served as the director of the American Academy in Rome and as director of the Visual Arts Program for the National Endowment for the Arts in Washington, D.C. I have to say, about 10 years ago, somewhat out of the blue, I got a letter from Jim. And I've held on to that letter, and it was basically about clay pedagogy and the power of clay to influence how one teaches. He is probably the ultimate sage or one of many in our fields, and his wisdom and his curiosity has been a gift for many. And he somehow has completely stayed up with the times. So it's a unique combination of that sense of reverence for the past and curiosity for the present. So Jim, we're very grateful to have you here. Welcome.
It's nice to be here. Very nice. It's nice to be able to take a turn. This was just wonderful this morning, and we're so lucky that there's an opportunity for us to see one another, talk with one another, and make good things happen. I like being part of us, and I'm amazed how many of us are here, actually. It's wonderful. Chris Daly just mentioned that I had once served as director of the visual arts program at the Arts Endowment in Washington. The endowment is in trouble now because there's an effort on the part of the new government, new administration, to look for, to eliminate agencies that cost money. The odd thing that people don't know about the endowment is that it generates more money than it spends. True. I mean, if a city wants to commission an artwork, a mural, sculpture, whatever it might be, they have to come up with half the money to which, and then make their proposal. And if the panelists at the endowment say, that is going to make a difference, positive difference, let's support it, the endowment becomes a partner in the project. Now, this partnership is really big. It's something that we know in NCECA. NCECA functions as a partner to us, for example. And we would lose a lot if we if the endowment was curtailed even more than it's already been. It doesn't look at all like it did when I was there in the 70s. There are no more fellowships for individual artists, except for writers, folk artists, and jazz musicians, but on only a very small scale. Now, I think that the trustees, all the museums and symphony orchestras and opera companies will probably pressure Congress to not to eliminate the agency, but I'm afraid it's going to be reduced a great deal. Now, there's something that we can do about it to keep it healthy, to keep it strong, and to keep it alive. And that has to do with contacting those members of Congress who represent us, people we have elected to represent us, let them know that this agency has a great record, that it is generating funds as it is generating all kinds of creative activity in all the arts. And I would also remind you that the people who make the decisions at the endowment are people like us, who come from different parts of the country, who are invited in. You take a turn and you sit on a panel and you weigh applications. Just the way it was a committee that selected the four people this morning who did that wonderful work. The endowment and the NCECA are not that different. One is located in a stationary place in a federal building in Washington, whereas we move around, and that's an advantage that we have. But a note, a message to your representatives will be noticed, maybe not read, but noticed. Sometimes I can well imagine somebody just checking, someone in an office, checking yes or no on issues. But the more yeses we send, the more we can make a difference and keep something that is positive and very good. Now, I'll begin my talk. Good. I decided that I wanted to dedicate this talk to something. 49 years ago, I was invited to give a keynote, it was quite an event. Before I left Berkeley for this, it's on my mind so much. Before I left Berkeley, I was on Shattuck Avenue taking care of some last business, and there was a kid, a black high school kid, standing on the corner, and he called me over, and he said, "I'll sing you a song if you give me a quarter." And so I said, "All right." And he sang me close to my ear this lovely song, and I gave him the quarter. But it was like being stopped by an angel. On my way to Kansas City, I will never forget that. These are the kind of human things that make a difference for us. And I'm still grateful to that boy, who's now probably a grandfather. Anyway, when I went to Kansas City, I dedicated my talk to a fellow potter who had recently passed away. And I'm glad I did. And I was thinking for today, Marilyn Levine is someone I would like to mention because I think that she didn't get the attention and respect and honors that she deserved, but her work is wonderful. Now, I first met Marilyn in Regina, Saskatchewan, way back in the, I suppose, late 60s, early 70s. I was to do a workshop. Well, there was an evening event, and I was to have people participate in a way to make some art. And so many people turned up that I thought, what are we going to do? So I suggested that we take an hour and everybody make a pair of shoes that we could then place on the floor of the gallery as though there were people there standing and talking. And so the shoes would represent these people. Well, Marilyn, I learned that she was so involved in making the show, she only got the first one made. And here, you know, saying, okay, now bring your shoes, place them. What was she gonna do? Well, she imagined the woman who was standing there, which actually leaning on a crutch. So she quickly made that little rubber cap that fits at the bottom of the crutch. And it was the best thing in the room. It was, what a show that was. That was nice. Well, it was maybe a year later. She decided to come to Berkeley and study with Pete Volkos. And she came with a master's degree in chemistry. And so she thought in terms of her work as research. And it continued that the art making she would be doing would be research. I like that a lot. And she started making shoes, but these would be like boots of friends, as though they were portraits of people, of the people who had worn them. And the more she got into developing a clay body that she needed, the more she was getting to know leather, and what leather looks like when it's used. And what I loved was not only being to look at a work and sense its history, but also to see someone using clay in a way that informs us about other materials and other things that have happened. So Marilyn, we dedicate this talk to you. Now, shared and unshared values of makers. Something that's so interesting about all of us is that we are so alike, and yet at the same time, there are many differences among us. And it's not differences like, well, I live in Omaha and you live in San Francisco or something like that. No. A question that has interested me for a long time is really, what kind of an artist are you? What sort of artist are you? And I learned something about that a few years ago when someone gave me a book about Hinduism, and I learned that among all the gods, there are three that have to do with art. Three gods of art, and they are different. So let me tell you about them. The followers of Vishnu, whether they're musicians, dancers, architects, woodworkers, the followers of Vishnu are dedicated to preserving forms and practices that have evolved over the years. Now, throughout history, potters have been involved with numerous forms that have been around for a long time. You can look in a book on ceramics history and you'll see some Minoan pot and you'll say, oh my goodness, that's familiar, that's good. Let me develop something on this. And you can keep our history alive by not only replicating works, but making them even nicer, more vital than they appear in the books. If we were to talk about music, now, this was way back in the 60s when I heard Glenn Gould, Glenn Gould's performance of the Goldberg variations. I knew the variations from other pianists, but Glenn Gould played them in such a way that not only me, but many people I knew just were listening to it as though for the first time. And it's very interesting that not long ago, some of us got emails from Bruce Nauman saying, you've got to hear the Goldberg variations of Glenn Gould. The performance is still alive. Now, as a result, we got interested again in Bach's keyboard music, thanks to an individual who alerted us to it with a new performance, new insights. And that's what Vishnu artists do. The late friend, Tony Hepburn, liked to bring up his mentor, Hans Koper, and Lucy Rhee. What strikes me about their wares is their distilling or abstracting traditional pottery forms, consistent in... Oh, excuse me, how did I get here? Oh, I skipped a page, but I'm not the first one in this room has done that, so. But I just want to talk first about Rozanji, because one time I was lucky enough to be in Tokyo when there was a big Rozanji exhibition, a retrospective. And what amazed me, first of all, was the range of his work. It wasn't just ceramics, but also he designed lamps and bases and bits of furniture. Now, Razanjan is interesting because he was a businessman, and he had restaurants, but he looked at the wares that were available for serving food, and he thought, oh, this is awful. So he said, we've just got to restore the beautiful wares that people have over the centuries enjoyed. And he found himself a potter, and he would sit next to the potter and tell him what to do, like throwing pieces, to resemble wares that would have come from one district or another. And in the process, explored quite a range of works. It's quite a tribute to the generations of Japanese craftsmen who came before him, but you know, it continues to inspire us. He keeps it alive. Now, there are among us many such gifted people. One whose aesthetic sensibility continues to be inspiring is Rick Hirsch, whose work I first encountered at an exhibition at Kansas City at the Nelson Atkins Museum. Now, there was this display case full of work that our that we were making, and I saw this piece of Rick's, and oh, it was like it just stopped me, and I stayed with it, and I will just never forget it. But it was something that part of his research into Shang Dynasty bronzes from China. And his variations just captured the essence of numerous forms, and with such spirit and skill that we could call them revelations. Now, I'll get on with Lucy Ree and Hans Koper. This is Hans Koper. Now, notice the respect that he has for both the vertical axis and the interior void. The interior of a vessel, now the wall is essentially the skin of the space. A couple of years ago, I was lucky enough, my daughter and son-in-law and I were able to go to Iran for 12 days. We rented a car, we had a driver, and we went around. And I discovered something about ceramics, not because of the tile work, which is what I had gone to see, but the architecture, the buildings. When you go into if you go into a mosque, it's not like going into a church or a cathedral here. It's, they're multi-chambered. But you go in, and while there are walls, what you really feel that is just palpable is the space that you're in. And there again, the ends of the space, they could be just as thin as paper, even though they're massive. And it's something that I must say took me a while to pick up, starting with Volkers. But he was there was another who had this great feeling of for the interior, the character of the interior of a vessel. And there is that link with architecture that I think that we should take very seriously. Now, this porcelain bowl of Lucy Rees is decorated with slanting lines that initiate spirals, going counterclockwise on the outside and clockwise inside, alluding to the upward spiral that a potter makes when throwing on the wheel. I also think of Ruth Duckworth, whom I've been fortunate enough to have known a bit. She once came to my studio, which just knocked me out. But she had such mastery that reaffirms the high standard of craftsmanship that is associated with Vishnu. Okay, now, when I was first learning to throw, I had some help from Gib Strawn, who had studied at Pond Farm with Marguerite Wildenhain. Her favorite word is said to have been discipline. I once had the pleasure of drinking from a cup that she had made, and I did enjoy it. The lip came out just enough to accommodate your own mouth in such a nice way. And it's funny how you can remember drinking from a cup and remember it and remember it. She's said to have been an effective teacher. I learned only recently that she had given Ken Price his first instruction in ceramics. If her values tie her to Vishnu, no one speaks better for the god Brahma than Price. Now, Ken Price was indeed disciplined. He was well-versed in drawing, printmaking. But he was constantly trying to extend his reach. And many of the shapes he was exploring suggest biological creatures, as though you were underwater. Or in a piece of this sort, where there are holes that reveal the activity of an interior life. One of the things that has been hard for some people to accept with Ken Price's work is that he didn't find that glazing a surface gave him what he wanted to have for a form. And so he began working with these synthetic coatings that are available for cars and for metal equipment and so on. And what's interesting to me that is with the forms themselves, he respected the opening into an interior. And in pieces like this, that entrance is really celebrated by the position that it's in. It is so tied to pottery. But with Brahma, you have invention and discovery and going beyond what we have already found. Now, one of his cups. One of the things that we have now and have had for years here at NCECA are the cup show. Where did that come from? Mostly from Kenny Price. We have him to thank for it. And that's one of those things. It takes an artist to come up with an idea that really catches hold with people and speaks to people. And I love the fact that we responded to this already, not just 10 years ago, 20 years ago, but back in the early 70s, mid the 60s, we began looking at Ken Price's cups. But one of the things that Ron Nagel and I were teaching at the Art Institute noticed right away was the color that he was getting. And that's when we decided, hey, maybe stoneware is not, it's not going to let us really say what we want to say. And so that's when we really switched to low temperature firing, just in order to get the color. And I must say, we must thank Ken Price for that. Now, I keep thinking of John Mason, who is will be celebrating his 90th birthday next week. And I owe him a great deal about the massiveness of clay. One of the things that I trust all of us have had the good experience is working in a shop with other other clay clay artists, that we we work harder when we have a little abrasion of somebody who's really got better ideas and doing working harder, and that makes us come up with working harder. And the more you work, the more ideas come. Pete Volkus's way of teaching was quite interesting, because he knew we were going to get more from fellow sculptors in his shop than we were going to get from him, because he was so advanced from us. Well, he found out that the university would allow him to have auditors, that if you are a professor at Cal, and I'm sure this is true of most universities, if someone approaches you and asks if they may audit your classes, you say, you can say yes, come in. And so Pete contacted ceramists in Los Angeles, whom he had worked with, and Mike Frimkus came up, Henry Takamoto came up, and John Mason, and they worked for several months alongside us. And so even though the courses were set up with just Volkus teaching, we had all this other activity going on around us. And Ann Adair, who later became Pete's wife, she was one of those people who came in as an auditor. What absolutely fascinated me years later was when John was questioning whether the hand was in fact essential in the making of work, and began working with Kilbrick. Now, as a potter, of course you're going to use Kilbrick. You get to know Kilbrick. You get to actually have a feeling for it, as opposed to ordinary brick. And he began assembling these forms. No, it was a very good idea, because once a show was organized for his work that was going to travel from one museum to another, by working with Kilbrick, he could move to the next city, order the bricks, do the sculptures, have the show, send the sculptures back, you sort of rent them for the exhibition, and then go to another. So there are no shipping costs. I mean, who would have thought of that? But I love the inventiveness that people like John had. Now, just to mention more recent work, this notion again of the vertical axis that has been so central to pottery vessel making. continuing in his work, but in a new form, and the notion of the spiral still continuing as an essential element. And John, thank you for these things, I must say. Now, a freedom that Betty Woodman has taken is quite interesting because she is one of those artists who looks across the wall to see what they're doing over there in painting. And this is very interesting for her, catching Matisse, looking at Matisse, has opened up paths for her that I think are really, it's so remarkable. Now, there's something that I think of how this was done the other way as well, with artists like Miró, for example, looking across the wall and again, working in ceramics. This is a good thing. And I think the one thing that's nice about an art school is that you are close to, you're only next door to activities in other areas that can inform your own. Okay, now, at the NCECA conference in Phoenix a few years ago, Nate Betschart and Brian Gillis co-curated a terrific show that they called The Margins. They had invited 30-some artists whose creative imaginations were occupied with entering new territory and checking it out. This is Del Harrow work. Now, these are Brahmins. We're talking about Brahmins. And they may be in minority. There are not as many Brahmins as there are Vishnu followers. But they are most certainly not marginal. Now, something that I want to say, you know, about these people who come in from the back door, as it were, who haven't been trained in, you know, pottery by a potter. And there's a tendency for us to not welcome them in. And, you know, it's the Miró, the Picasso. Picasso is an example of people from other fields. But with Charles Simmons, he's a very interesting artist, and all of his work is with clay. If you don't know about it, what he's most best known for is making little bricks out of clay, but instead of firing them, the clay, he just uses Elmer's glue. And he makes all these little bricks, will ride on his bicycle to some location in the city, and as people are around paying attention, watching, he will find a niche in some wall and build the ruins of people who had lived in this these buildings and so on at some time. And these are like going back into history. This wonderful kind of exploration that he does. So I'll just mention his name, Charles Simmons. It'd be nice to us to recognize him as one of us. Now, this is something interesting. Pete Volkus's enthusiasm for Picasso's wares helped get him fired from his position at Otis, the Los Angeles Institute of Art, back in the late 50s. If a picture playfully decorated by Picasso can cost you your job, you can imagine what alarms went off the day Duchamp placed a lowly utilitarian vessel in a museum show. To many viewers, it was more than ridiculous that an object akin to a chamber pot could claim a place in the history of art. To this day, there are schools of art that discourage any mention of Duchamp and his assertion that art is whatever you choose to call art. Now, such an attack on the underpinnings of aesthetic value systems would offend both the Vishnu and the Brahma camps. Duchamp's god, however, was Shiva, Shiva the destroyer, the dangerous one who would create by first clearing the field and starting over. Now, potters in the Vishnu camp are not likely to lose sleep over Duchamp, but a colleague closer to home in the 1950s hit them hard, namely Peter Volkas. Now, he broke through the walls of what was acceptable in the canon of his day. I myself first saw his work, his show in 1957 in the at the Chicago Art Institute, and I was horrified by what I saw. I was so shocked that, as some of you know, I finally decided that I'm going to have to get this out of my system, so I signed up for a summer class of his at Missoula. I thought he had to be a charlatan, only to find that this is a person who, to whom I owe an enormous change in my life. It's like changing directions completely. And I will forever be grateful for what he gave me in terms of the questions he introduced me to. And the insights that he gave us. Now, I wasn't the only one to react to his work as I did. He was announced by potters throughout the country. Chief among them was Carlton Ball. Oh, this is another focus piece. But there is a piece. When I was first studying, getting to know Pete in 58, Carlton Ball's letters in the ceramics magazines were really bitter, angry. And as a graduate student, Sandy Johnstone and I went to San Jose State, where the instructor was in ceramics, was giving a presentation, and there was going to be a workshop coming up with a Japanese ceramist. And so we asked him if, even though we weren't students at San Jose State, could we join you? And he said, well, as students of Peter Volkas, you would hardly have the technical know-how to understand what you saw. So we weren't let into the workshop. But that's how those feelings were. What angered Pete Volkas was the rigidity of views on what a ceramist was allowed to investigate, even conceive of. His struggle for freedom opened many doors, more doors than we ever imagined. And thanks to him, the number of Brahmins among us grew rapidly, and with it, the redefinition and the reimagination of ceramic art. Now, I would like to end by noting that while it's helpful to sort out the various persuasions that drive us artists, all three Hindu gods may very well have had us on their laps at one time or another. And I certainly must say that the movement between them, between the Brahmins and the Vishnus, is particularly fluid. You may agree. Okay.